So good morning. Thank you for joining us. My name is Leigh Hopper and I work in media relations at USC where I promote science and our research. And today we have with us one of our experts. Her name is Rita Burke. She is an assistant clinical professor of preventive medicine and her area of expertise is public health responses to disasters. Now, until this year, that would have been earthquakes, hurricanes, wildfires, but this year we have pandemics added to that list. And sort of her area of focus is children's response to these kinds of disasters. So we thought she'd be perfect to talk about how we can maintain a sense of normalcy during the pandemic, especially during the holiday season, starting with Halloween.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. The big question this year is Halloween canceled? And the answer is a resounding no, it's not canceled. It's just going to be a little bit different this year, and that's okay. When you think about Halloween, it really comes down to the costumes and candy. So as parents, we have to think about, well, how can we incorporate costumes and candy for our kids and make sure that it's still safe in this time during COVID? So here are a few ideas. If you have little kids, think about getting dressed in your costume. Maybe even if you have a pet, dress up the pet and go for a walk around your neighborhood during Halloween. You can also do a scavenger hunt with little kids. So hide candy around the house or around the yard and have them try to find the candy. If you are seeing other families, you can also invite other families. The guidance from our local public health department is not more than 3 families, including your own. Make sure that there is plenty of space so you can socially distance and make sure that everyone is wearing masks. You can also have a Halloween themed meal, of course, also following that same guidance. Not more than 3 families, including your own. Make sure that when you're not eating, everyone is wearing masks. You can also do some car drive-throughs. So get everyone in their costume, go around the neighborhood to see all the wonderful decorations. You can also really decorate your house this year and put all in to make your house super festive for Halloween. And you can also, perhaps as a way to support your local restaurants, some are offering Halloween themed meals. And so you can do some outside dining with your family. For older kids, I have to be a little bit more creative where something that they're also going to enjoy and, you know, still feel cool. So maybe a Zoom themed party with some Halloween music in the background. I think they'd also enjoy a scavenger hunt and also maybe a Halloween themed party with, again, not more than 3 families. The main thing is to really talk about what's going on with your kids. A lot of times when there is an event like this, we feel it's our responsibility to shelter our kids and to not expose them to what's going on. And that really is a mistake. They're perfectly capable of handling this emotionally. We just have to make sure that when we talk to them, it's on a developmentally appropriate scale. So we can talk to them about why we can't do their traditional trick or treat that we normally do, how it's important for us to socially distance and to wear masks. And we can't go out and trick or treat like we normally do because we're concerned about other people and it's just to keep everyone safe. This is also a great opportunity to talk to our kids about empathy. We're doing this because we have empathy and we care about other people. We don't want other people to get sick. We don't want anyone else in our family, grandma or grandpa, to get sick. And so Halloween is going to be a little bit different this year, and that's okay. They're also going to be looking to us and how we react. If we as parents make a huge deal about we're not able to go trick-or-treating this year, how horrible, they're going to take that message away. Instead, it's really important for us to model that positive behavior and say, okay, Halloween is a little bit different this year, but that's okay. Perhaps we can even come up with some new traditions as a family around Halloween and start our scavenger hunt that we've never done before. But because Halloween is different this year, let's try that. Or let's try going for a walk in our costumes around the neighborhood this year. So this is really a great opportunity, actually, for families to really focus on themselves, to start new traditions, and to have that open dialogue with kids around why we're doing what we're doing.
So a lot of, there's been a lot of publicity about these creative ways to distribute candy, like a candy shoot or, just other funny things like that. Do you think there's a way to do that safely? Is there a way that people that maybe don't have kids, but they are expecting trick-or-treaters on Halloween to participate safely? Or should you just shut your door and turn off the lights and pretend you're not home?
So encouraging trick-or-treating is really, it's not encouraged this year by our local health department. And the reason for that is because it's really going to be difficult to ensure socially distancing kids. And, you know, what Halloween is about getting your hands into the candy bowl, and we really don't want kids to be doing that. I can't ensure that everyone is going to be wearing masks. And so we really, really want to reiterate how important it is to socially distance. So for that reason, it's really not encouraged, because even though you may set out a bowl of candy on your porch, you're not going to be able to control how many kids congregate on your porch at one time. So again, it's not encouraged this year.
Now, looking ahead a little bit, after Halloween, then we start looking towards Thanksgiving and we start looking towards Christmas. Do you have any thoughts about that?
There is certainly more pressure. Thanksgiving and Christmas are almost synonymous with family. But there are ways to go about it this year in a safe manner so that we can keep everyone safe and we can get back to quote unquote normal sooner. So again, if you are going to get together with your family, no more than 3 separate households, including your own, and really make use of Zoom. I know it's difficult sometimes, but again, we have to keep in mind the big picture, and that's to keep everyone safe so that we can start getting together as soon as possible. And also the same advice applies as I mentioned around Halloween. Try to think of new traditions for your families that you can participate in, that you can involve everyone in. So maybe, you know, if everyone is all over the country, some sort of game that you can all play through Zoom that would give you an opportunity to see everyone in your family and to engage, but to do so in a safe manner.
Hey, Rita, yeah, this is Jackie. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about if kids are hearing conflicting messages from adults in their lives. Some people might agree with the decision to have a Zoom Thanksgiving while others don't, and kids can hear both messages. So if you could speak about that a little bit, that would be helpful.
Sure. And that's really difficult when kids hear conflicting messages. My suggestion would be to have an open dialogue with your children again and say, you know, Uncle Joe says that it's safe, but mom and dad are saying that it's not safe, and here's why. And we're also going to talk to Uncle Joe. That open dialogue is really key, and I can't reiterate that enough, because again, we sometimes think that it's important to protect kids. And when we say protect, sometimes we think not to talk to them and not to have that open dialogue. But that's really a big mistake. Kids are completely capable of understanding why we're doing something and why we're making the decisions that we're making, as long as we explain it to them in a developmentally appropriate fashion.
Is there a resource available with developmentally appropriate language?
So the Centers for Disease Control has developed some guidance, and a great resource actually is the American Academy of Pediatrics. they have a lot of material on their website around how to talk to kids around these issues.
Can you tell us a little bit about how you've been talking, or what sorts of things do you hear from your child?
Sure thing. So I have a 10-year-old boy who's going on 30. He certainly has become frustrated at this point around COVID and that he can't see his friends. But I do try to reiterate the importance of continuing to socially distance. Wearing masks is also a big thing. Why do I have to wear this mask? And for Halloween, we're starting our own tradition. So we've never done a scavenger hunt before. And so I went to the store the other day and bought a bag of candy, and I'm going to scatter it all around our backyard and give him 10 minutes to find as many candy bars as he can. So that's actually a really fun tradition that I'm looking forward to continuing even after this is over. So again, there's a lot of negative, but there can also be a lot of positive, and it's our attitude as parents, how we model it for our children. That's what they're going to take away from it, and that's what they're going to model in return.
I also think that here in California, we have such nice weather, or mild weather most of the time. It's really pretty easy to move things outdoors.
Absolutely, absolutely. And we're very lucky in that. So we pay for it by traffic, but we get a lot in return. The other important thing, if I may just mention, I had received some questions around, well, a lot of the costumes come with masks. So is that okay? So if my child doesn't want to wear their usual cloth mask, can they substitute the Halloween mask? And the answer is a resounding no. And the reason is because the Halloween masks are not designed to protect individuals from the virus, from any respiratory droplets, whereas the cloth masks are. So you want to make sure that if you dress your child up and the costume comes with a mask, you wear the cloth mask, not the costume mask. And you don't want to double up, because then it may make it difficult to breathe. Start that conversation with your family now about how you're thinking about celebrating the holidays, Thanksgiving and Christmas, and try to come up with some creative ways that everyone in your family can participate in. And again, just start thinking about those traditions that you can create for your family.